know though of a certainty that in every dispensation, now when he says every dispensation, he means the dispensation of Muhammad, of Christ, of Buddha, the Bahá'u'lláh. In every dispensation, the light of divine revelation hath been vouchsafed to men in direct proportion to their spiritual capacity. Consider the sun, how feeble its rays, the moment it appeareth above the horizon, how gradually its warmth and potency increase as it approacheth its zenith, enabling meanwhile all created things to adapt themselves to the growing intensity of its light. How steadily it declineth until it reacheth its setting point. Were it, all of a sudden, to manifest the energies latent within it, it would, no doubt, cause injury to all created things. In like manner, if the Sun of Truth were suddenly to reveal, at the earliest stages of its manifestation, the full measure of the potencies which the providence of the Almighty hath bestowed upon it, the earth of human understanding would waste away and be consumed. For men's hearts would neither sustain the intensity of its revelation, nor be able to mirror forth the radiance of its light. Dismayed and overpowered, they would cease to exist. Now this actually is, and see, I read it so I get to comment. This actually, if you think about it, is a second kind of progressive revelation. Between dispensations, there is progressive revelation. Within a dispensation, there is progressive revelation. If you know your Bible, you can go to the New Testament, and you can see that when Christ first spoke, he didn't tell his disciples who he was. They had some feeling. They were attracted to him. Then finally he said, who do you think I am? Who do the people say I am? Who do you think I am? Peter said, thou art Christ, Son of the living God, right? And he said, thou art Peter, Cephas, and upon this rock I build my church. And he said at that point, he said, just tell the Jews. And you have to go all the way to Acts, past the four Gospels, all the way to Acts before it says, now, tell the world. All right? So first it was a secret, then there was a small group, then it was just the Jews, then it was all mankind. This is progressive revelation within a dispensation. And this is the principle that Bahá'u'lláh is speaking about. Christ spoke about it too. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now.
Patience.
The advent of a manifestation of God depends upon the existence of a person, the first believer, who has the capacity to understand and embrace his thoughts. Should such an individual be found among mankind, God will immediately reveal himself and will not postpone his revelation, even for a fraction of a minute. The Bab gives the example of his own revelation and states that since the appearance of Muhammad, God has been watching for a person to appear and become the recipient of the message. And that it took 1,260 lunar years until Mullah Hussein acquired the capacity to know him. The Bab further asserts that had Mullah Hussein been ready to acknowledge the truth of his cause one moment earlier than he did, he would have correspondingly revealed himself to him that much sooner.
Wow.
That's good.
All right, now this really, Gregory, did you want to say something?
Well, I get moved. So I'm a Bobby. I'm a Bobby. So anything Bob.
Yeah, you got a Bobby again?
No, but I'm sorry. So I get moved. Anything that is attributed to the Bob, it just moves me. But this, it's mind boggling how simple, not easy. They're not the same, but how simple is it is when we prepare ourselves. I know the story of Mullah Hussein and how he found the Bab. And he walked. He was just telling somebody the story. He walked, and he was not a young man, and he was not well to do this. But that when his teacher said go, he went. He didn't think about it. He didn't question it. He just left. So for them to know that the Baha was waiting and that God has given us this amazing grace of saying all you have to do is pay attention. 1 minute sooner or 1 minute later, conversely, the converse is true.
Sure.
Because if it took 1,260 million years, there's all the time on the planet. And I don't mean that, I really am not a blah blah person. Trust me, I've been into this serious.
And you know, Mullah Hussein, you may recall also that Mullah Hussein was charged by the Bab not to tell anyone.
That's right.
And that he was silent for 40 days.
Yes.
Can you imagine the tremendous, incredible, I mean, this would be like, God only knows, to have this knowledge within you and to be silent for 40 days. Yeah, but I think this is Teherzadeh speaking. This is not scripture, but it's a fascinating. But what he's telling us is something that the Bab says. He's sort of giving it to us in his own words. But this is a fascinating idea because it really points out this idea of maturity, the maturity of mankind, which is encapsulated in this case in one person. Right? Who was it at the time of Christ? Peter. You know? Man hath not revealed this to you. God hath revealed this to you. Thou art Peter, Cephas, and upon this rock I build my church. At the time of Muhammad, who was it? The first believer?
Ali.
It was Ali? Alright? And so for every revelation we have this, you were speaking of this pattern of rejection. But the pattern shows up in many, many ways, and this is one of them. This idea of the first believer is also something that occurs. And this really is the sort of the trailbreaker for all mankind, showing us what's going to happen in the coming centuries with this revelation. Mankind will be impacted, affected by this, right? First Peter, now 1 billion people.
But it only takes one. That's the other thing that's impressive to me, that it doesn't take 50 bazillion. It takes one. And from that one, lots of things, amazing things can happen.
Yes.
Even if you have to keep silence, even if you have to walk across the country, even if you have to sacrifice everything you have, it just that one is what gets revealed. God will not hold back if one shows up and says it is.
I don't know of an authoritative record about who the first was with Mahoma. But I suspect that it was Abdullah. Does anybody know authoritative?
Contemplating the helplessness, the fears, and miseries of humanity in this day, and no longer question the necessity for a fresh revelation of the quickening power of God's redemptive love and guidance.
All right, so he's saying, this is Shoghi Effendi, and he's saying, look, things are bad. Obviously, what's needed is God has to speak to us.
On one hand, the stupendous advance achieved in the realm of human knowledge, of power, of skill, and inventiveness, and viewing on the other the unprecedented character of the suffering that afflict and the dangers that we have beset present-day society, can be so blind as to doubt that the hour has at last struck for the advent of a new revelation, for a restatement of the divine purpose, and for the consequent revival of those spiritual forces that have, at fixed intervals, rehabilitated the fortunes of human society. I'm with Randy.
Readers.
We have a group going.
Unity.
Unity.
Well, I mean, in sum, isn't he saying, things are both terrible and astonishing.
Exactly, yeah.
And anyone who believes in God has to be impelled to wonder, you know, where is the new message? Where is this new energy that God is going to reject into mankind? Now is the time. This is the hour. Yeah, I agree.
We only get a manifestation when we hit the lowest depths we can as human beings.
To some degree, right, right.
Yeah,
because
we
it's
to,
spring,
we have
spring
to
summer,
we
autumn,
have,
winter.
That's right. We have to sink. And then when it gets almost
we have to rot.
To the point, I like that.
So why don't we have one now?
We do. It's 160 shut up, 168
well,
years
I
ago.
Understand
we
that, but we're, that wasn't the bottom then. We're still going
there. Well, but I think we're limited as to how we recognize and know what the bottom is.
If you look at things 168 years ago,
it's pretty bad.
It was terrible. I mean, diseases ravaged mankind, and we had absolutely no defense against them. It was the age of kings, and when a king,
but it was also the age of great advancement, technological advancement. That time.
No,
didn't really come until after that.
In 1844, they were going to close the copyright office because so little was being
produced.
Yeah.
Well,
and
see,
since then, it's been like a gazillion things.
Astonishing.
That's America. We have to realize this whole globe here.
This is the whole world we're talking about.
But the other thing that you have to remember is back then, the media wasn't exposing every little horrible thing that was out there like they are now. It's kind of thrown in our face now, so it seems like it's worse than it was before, but actually, it is.
The street was the sewer. If you walked along the street, people would throw out their night soil. There's a term for you.
The condition of man was not protected by those who were the sovereign or the one, the religious leaders. The religious leaders and the king were supposed to have been the protector of their subjects.
I'm not talking about Western. What about
the
Western? South American. What about
the same? There were all. What do you think? This the Aztec. The Aztec calendar is the only thing remains of the Aztec period, and they were in the height of their glory at one time, and that civilization is left. I mean, what? What information do we know about the Aztec? Very little. But we have realized and recognized through their sculpture or arts or whatever that they have dug up that there was a tremendous amount of wonderful civilization existed, but it had been all destroyed. Why? And in 1800, the kings and the noblemen were not interested in their subjects at all. Every king, whether they were in Persia or in Europe, what do you think that period of Queen, whatever her name was, 11 E.K.? That was that period. At that time, they not only killed the king, but they killed his wife, his children, everybody was beheaded because their subjects were so fed up.
So we've stepped forward. And the slides that I left out had to do with this idea of the promise that is enshrined in all of the scriptures. All right? Which is the promise of the maturation of mankind, the coming of the golden age. All right? Christ says, for example, there shall be one fold and one shepherd, and his name one. All right? If we look at all past dispensations, we find this same kind of promise. Something wonderful is coming. Something wonderful is coming. Now, the question then is, and that's identified with the revelation of Bahá'u'lláh. This is not only the day, this is the one who is going to bring this golden age. But if you think about it, this can be a controversial idea. It's nice in the abstract, but what do we mean by this golden age? What do we mean by the government of God on earth? Well, it says in the Baha'i writings that through a gradual process, the Baha'i faith will expand until it is accepted by the vast majority of mankind. And at some point in that process, all right, obviously things will change a great deal. You were talking about changes in government, for example.